Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the International Symposium on China's Rise and the Emerging Democratic Frontier in Asia-Pacific. 各位女士先生早安，欢迎来参加中国崛起和亚太民主连线行程的国际研讨会。Now we are, have the opening section. We will invite the Dr. Luo Fuchen to give us the opening address. 现在现在我们来进行开幕的致辞，我们来邀请罗福全博士给我们致辞。
苏定昌主席，各位贵宾先进，大家晚安，大家好。请代表台湾安保协会欢迎大家来参加2013年年度的这国际研讨会，大家来共同讨论中国的崛起和亚太民主连线的形成这个议题。May I take this opportunity to extend our warm welcome to the distinguished speakers from United States, Mr. Stephen Yeh, from Japan, former Minister of Defense, Mr. Morimoto, and Dr. Kogane Maru, from India, Mr. Bhaskar. Their presence will enrich our conference on the broader view of regional security issues in the Asia-Pacific region. Welcome to the International Symposium on China's Rise and the Emerging Democratic Frontier in Asia-Pacific. 我想我就可以用那个中文来讲，因为真侪人也要听。在2011年的国际研讨会上，我们曾经提出如何维护台海和平。并非台湾与中国一对一的关系，台海和平是亚太区域和平非常重要的一个环节。最近，中国国家主席习近平在美西会晤美国奥巴马总统的时候，曾经表示，太平洋可以容纳两大国的想法。但是美国重返亚洲的决心不变。近年来，中国与美国在亚太区域逐步提升战略上的影响力，台湾绝不是一个被孤立的国家。两岸如何维持和平，台湾如何积极与中国对话，现在台湾在亚太区域的战略地位非常重要。2010年7月，在越南河内的东协区域论坛上，中国宣称南海140万平方里为中国的核心利益，如同西藏与台湾。美国国务卿 Hillary Clinton 对此公开宣誓，以和平方式解决南海的争议是美国的国家利益。美国支持各方在不受威胁下采取合作的外交途径解决各国的领土争议，反对任何一方用武力或威胁的方式。2012年，中国宣布南海的东沙群岛、西沙群岛、南沙群岛领域成为三沙市，并派遣巡逻艇维护这个区域。一年来，中国跟越南、中国跟菲律宾在这个区域的纷争不断。2012年的6月2号，美国当时的国防部长 Penetus 在新加坡 Shangri-La Hotel 举行的第11届亚洲安全会议上宣示美国重返亚洲，提出 rebalancing 再平衡的战略，准备在2020年美国海军舰队由目前的 50% 增加到 60% 部署在亚洲，包括6个航空 战斗群。Panitas 在那个以后，六月五号就到印度去拜访印度的首相 Manmohan Singh， 表达美国在亚洲提升海军部署是基于 rebalancing 军事力量的一个平衡。印度是世界最大的民主国家，美国针对中国海军强化，希望与包括印度洋的亚太区域同盟友好国家关系紧密化，并向外宣示美军在这区域的 presence 的存在的目的。 Panitas 称日本为区域安全的基石，强调日本是支持美国非常重要的同盟国。最近日本防卫部署军事力量提升，逐步扩张，配合美国再平衡的战略。美国决心提升同盟国的参与，并提升海军力量，维护包括印度洋的亚太区域的安全。在这里我应该强调的是，美国的战略部署并不是冷战时代的围堵战略 containment strategy， no， 对中国更不是一个敌对关系，而是基于劝阻战略 dissuasion strategy， 就是希望中国在亚洲扮演一个建设性的角色。什么是劝阻战略 dissuasion strategy？ 象征性的发展就是日美同盟在2005年2月由双方的外交部长、国防部长发表的所谓2+2宣言，表示日美共同战略目标有三个重点。第一个就是要求中国在亚洲扮演建设性的角色。第二个，关于台湾问题，日美向中国提出有关台湾海峡的问题，敦促中国应该要经由对话以和平的方式解决。第三个，这是非常重要的一点，就是要提升日美对中国军事抑制力量作为后盾。你要是没有这个军事力量做后盾，他不会听你的话。所以2012年美国提出 rebalancing 战略，就是再平衡的战略，完全是基于提升对中国军事抑制力量的具体政策，尤其对台海维护和平采取一贯的立场。我在去年台湾安保学会的会议上曾经提出一个见解，中国经济成长逐步现代化，那将来是不是能够像台湾、韩国一样，从一个党政军结合的专制体制步上民主化的国家呢？还是将以非常狭义的中国 nationalism 中国民主主义为后盾，逐步倾向军事冒险主义国家？中国要走哪一条路？今后中国的动向使亚太区域逐步迈向一个不确定时代 ，age of uncertainty。因为如此，日美同盟与亚洲民主国家的连线，也提升最制衡的军事力量，使它成为一道具有组合性的防波堤，其能抑制因为中国崛起所引起的任何两国之间有关领土、领海的冲突。这个并不会要跟中国敌对，而是希望能促使中国在现代化的过程中在亚洲扮演建设性的角色。美国一再宣示重返亚洲是美国的国家利益，在这个大环境中，台海的和平是维持亚太区域 balance of power 军事中非常重要的一个环节。台湾并不是一个被孤立的国家，台湾是亚太区域拥有民主主义共同价值观的国家的重要伙伴。谢谢。
Now we will have the opening keynote speech. We will invite the chairman of Democratic Progressive Party, Mr. Xu Zhenchang. 现在我们要来进行的是我们贵宾的致辞，我们要来邀请民主进步党主席苏贞昌先生。
台湾安保协会的理事长，日本前方的大臣新本命教授，我的好朋友 Steven Yates， 各位与会国际和国内贵宾，各位女士、各位先生、各位媒体的朋友，大家好，早，大家好。我想也访罗理事长，我要让更多有些外国的好朋友能够了解，我用北京语哈来，他我给那里所谓表示的意见。我很荣幸能够再度应邀出席今年台湾安保协会举办的国际研讨会。去年大会的主题是中国的崛起与亚太区域的安全，我们共同关注的是伴随着中国崛起对亚太区域带来的挑战。今年的主题是中国崛起与亚太民主国家连线的形成，是进一步寻求亚太稳定和平机制的建立。我要先对大会的战略思考与用心的安排表达最高的敬意，尤其对罗理事长学养丰厚，并且对于整个台湾，尤其在民进党执政的时候驻日各方面所做的巨大贡献。民进党刚在这一段期间办八年执政的研讨会，特别大家对于那时候我们的罗理事长还有在座许大使等在驻日方面的努力表示相当大的肯定跟感谢。一年来我们见证了亚太政经情势的重大转变，也深深影响着亚太安全、和平与繁荣的次序重整。美国奥巴马总统连任成功，立刻进行了任内第五度的访问亚洲行程，包括第一次的造访缅甸，随后改组了国安的团队，重申美国对亚洲的再平衡政策不变。日本安倍首相与自民党接连的赢得了众院跟参院的选举，终止了扭曲国会的现象，致力推动安倍经济学，重建日本在亚洲的领导地位。美日两国的元首也重申美日安保的重要性，而南韩的大统领也已经更迭，中国也完成了领导人的登替，习近平与李克强的习李体制正式接班。对内面对经济成长与金融、社会体制等潜在挑战，对外则展开了新型大国关系的经营。首次的欧习会也在六月在美国的加州举行。当然，我们更不能忽略印度强化其东望的外交政策与后续中美印日四国关系的发展。在个别区域挑战方面，北韩的金正恩政权动辄挑战东北亚安全的举动，急需各国透过国际建制协商合作加以制衡。东海与钓鱼台争端随着台湾与日本签订了渔业协议后暂时获得了化解，但日中关系仍然充满着不确定性，南海主权争议持续僵持，有赖相关各造摒弃成见，共同建立行为准则，维持航行自由。美国积极推动环太平洋伙伴协议 TPP， 日本也于七月正式加入协商，成为 TPP 第十二个会员国。未来 TPP 与东协加六的区域全面性伙伴协议 RCEP 之间的竞争关系，将考验各国对外贸易政策开放程度的角力。上述的种种发展 层面扩及外交、军事、安全、经贸，乃至于各国国内的政治跟社会情况，让亚太政经秩序面临着更复杂的重整挑战，考验各国领导人的智慧，也促成了一个成熟稳定区域建制的必要性。今年的二月初，正当钓鱼台问题引发日中关系紧张，甚至可能挑战到美日安保体系之际，曾昌率领民主进步党代表团访问东京，除了与执政的自民党重要领导人会晤，也会见超过60位跨党派的日本国会议员。大家共同关切的议题就是钓鱼台的争议，以及台湾逐渐靠向中国可能危及日本能源进出口生命线。我与日本朝野领袖皆认为，台日两国对于钓鱼台领土主权各有坚持，但维持区域和平与稳定则是台日最高的共同利益。当务之急就是尽快完成台日渔业协议的谈判与签署，避免让其他的势力介入，以至于恶化了东海的情势。就在我访日回国不久后，台湾的总统马英九终于做出明确的宣示，就是两岸绝不联手保钓。紧接着在四月，台日也顺利签署了渔业协议。马政府从初期的模拟摇摆，让北京有可乘之机，形塑了两岸联手保钓抗日的印象。这不仅有损台日的关系，也会让美国卷入钓鱼台的争端。民进党乐见马政府清楚地展现立场，民进党执政时期就已经致力于台日渔业协议的谈判，这些发展都和曾昌向日本朋友传达的意思一致。访日的期间，我也正式提出建立民主同盟的主张。有鉴于亚太政经情势的变化莫测，我认为要维持此一区域的安定与繁荣，包括美国、日本、韩国、台湾，乃至于南亚的印度，这些有共同信仰民主、自由、人权的国家，应该强化民主同盟的伙伴。这也呼应了本届大会主题诉求的亚太民主连线。这样的民主同盟，结合冷战时期东西阵营对视的思维，也不是要用来围堵哪一个国家，反而是回到相关国家最基本的价值共识，也就是民主，用对话代替对抗，以和平化解冲突，用民主决定未来。今年六月，我访问美国华府，与奥巴马政府亚太事务官员会谈，也在智库的 Brookings 跟国际战略研究中心 CSIS 合办的场合发表演说。我提出三个 R 的诉求，也就是责任 Responsibility、 和解 Reconciliation 和再平衡 Rebalance。 我重申民进党致力于良好执政能力的准备，以及承担未来重新治理台湾的责任。我提出用和解与对话来促进两岸关系正常化与区域和平。我呼吁美国在重返亚洲的战略蓝图中重新平衡台美关系，让台湾成为美国亚洲再平衡战略中的重要拼图。台湾不应该只消极地做一个沉默的旁观者，而应该扮演积极建设性的区域秩序促进者的角色。维持两岸关系的和平稳定发展固然符合国际期待，但绝不能以台湾主权与民主自由为代价。民主是台湾最大的资产，也是连结区域民主同盟国家共同的语言，更是 敦促非民主国家开展政治改革以遵守国际规范的力量。我们敦促北韩能够接受国际建制，放弃核武。我们期待崛起的中国能妥善处理内部问题，承担更多的国际责任，尊重台湾人民的自由意志。面对中国迄今仍未放弃以武力解决台湾问题的立场，台湾一方面要努力让两岸关系正常化，同时也必须强化自我国防的防卫能力。最近台湾的军队发生陆军下士洪仲秋遭内不幸致死案，导致两任的国防部长在一个礼拜内先后下台，严重的打击了国军的自信跟士气，也伤害民众对国军的信任，这是非常遗憾的事情。加上马政府上任以来始终无法落实国防预算达 GDP 三个百分点的承诺，再再暴露了台湾的国防危机，让台湾成为亚太区域和平与安全的缺口。作为负责任的在野党，民进党早在六月就发表国防蓝皮书，以过去执政时期明确履行国防预算占 GDP 三个百分点的事实，严肃地提出军人有信心，民众能信赖，友邦能信任的新三信心，作为向美国、日本等国的战略在保证。各位贵宾、各位女士、各位先生，民主进步党曾经执政过，我们也针对执政时期各项国内外的政策虚心地进行检讨，作为未来执政的准备。过去这段时间，我们努力获得多数台湾人民的支持，民进党的政党支持度也稳定地超越国民党，民进党的地方治理能力也广获台湾民众的肯定。我们将以稳健、自信、负责的迈向重新执政之路。台湾人民对民进党期待越深，民进党就更要致力于良好治理能力的强化。国际社会对民进党的关注日盛，过去一年多来，我们也用实际的行动展现了对区域伙伴们的承诺。民进党会用负责任和具战略高度的政策，来确保重新执政后的两岸和平与区域繁荣。最后，再一次的感谢主办单位的邀请，也预祝大会顺利成功，大家健康快乐，谢谢大家。
Thanks for the chairman's speech. 我们感谢咱苏主席给咱的演讲。Now we are going to the first section, the U.S. rebalance to Asia and the role for Taiwan. 今麦咱要来进行第一场的研讨会。第一场研讨会题目是美国再平衡政策甲台湾的角色。Now we will invite the moderator of the first section, Dr. Mark Chen Tangshan, the legislator and the former Minister of Foreign Affairs.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Thank you. 大家早上好，这真准时啦，九点半啊，所以这我一定会准时啊。Well, we are very pleased to have my good friend Mr. Stephen Yates and two of my very long time colleagues to be here this morning. And this session is very important. I think the topics will be, Mr. Stephen Yates is going to talk about is the politics, strategy, and reality of U.S. rebalancing implications for Taiwan.Let me spend a couple of minutes to introduce my good friend Stephen Yates. I have known him for several years, and I had dinner, even breakfast, I think one of my good friends in Washington, D.C. for several years. And, Steve Yates is well known to many friends here in Taiwan. He's visited Taiwan several times. And he was a former deputy assistant to the vice president Chinese office for national security affairs between 2001 to 2005. Now currently he is the CEO at DC International Advisory. My own personal understanding is Steven Yates is what I would call a rising star in US politics. So today we are very happy to have him to talk, present this very special, interesting topics to us. And my other two good friends, they are high power, I call them, real high powered. Discussants. To my left, Michael Gao, who has been in academics for many, many years, and he used to be a professor teaching at in Rhode Island. Brown University for several, several years. And after he returned from that teaching position, he was invited to hold very important positions in the security matters as much as the foreign affairs. So he was one time the deputy minister of foreign affairs. At that time, I was minister of foreign affairs, and he was the guy who did everything for me. And so I really appreciate his talent. And then he was also our ambassador to European Union in Brussels for several years. And to my right, extreme right, Wu Zhaoxie, Dr. Wu. He was also a professor with a real strong academic background. And of course, with this kind of, with that kind of talent, he was invited also to work for former President Chen Shui-bian. Then in the end, he was appointed to stay in Washington, D.C. as our ambassador to the United States. He did a real profound, real exceptional good work trying to, in the real critical moment, he did real nice work representing Taiwan. So we appreciate it very much. And I think I'm only allowed to speak for 5 minutes. What time is it now? Okay, so I'm still okay. So my good friend Mr. Law told me that all together we have 1 hour, and as the main speaker for Mr. Yates, I think you have 25 minutes. And our two high power discussants, each one has 15 minutes. And I don't know whether we might have some time to be left for our audiences to raise some questions. I don't know. Then I think we'll find out. Okay. So with that brief introductions, please, Steve. Thank you. Yeah.
各位爱台湾的朋友，大家好。It is an honor to return to the Taiwan National Security Institute. And it is a pleasure to be on the podium with very distinguished servants for Taiwan. I am grateful for their public service and the sacrifices they have made for Taiwan. And I am also honored that they have been friends and mentors and colleagues over the years. Also, very honored today to share opportunity to speak with distinguished visitors from Japan and India, countries with whom we have common values and I think increasing common interests. So thank you very much for having me. I'll try to be relatively brief. I say at the outset that the comments that I offer are not unbiased. I am a conservative Republican. And I have some modest experience in government and politics, and Of course, what I have to say will be informed by my point of view, but I hope you might just the same consider what I hope will be a constructive critique of what I see as the politics, strategy, and reality of U.S. rebalancing. First, talk a bit about the politics of the pivot. Sometimes politics is considered a dirty word when discussing foreign policy, but politics is the reality of how our governments are formed, the environment in which they execute policy, and it is an important ingredient in helping shape what opportunities and challenges leaders will face. When it comes to the pivot to Asia, really the idea was born out of the 2008 presidential campaign. The 2008 presidential campaign was the first cycle in several years when foreign policy and national security really was a weakness for the Republican Party. There had been thought to have been an advantage, and in fact, 4 years prior, probably it was views on national security that in the end tipped the balance between a very close election between George W. Bush and John Kerry. But by 2008, so much had changed. The country was weary of a long period of war. The conduct of the war became less and less popular. And so an opening was made for a political rising star in America to offer a criticism of the Bush administration, but also to distinguish himself from the leading challenger in the Democratic Party, then Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton had voted in favor of authorizing force with regard to the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, and then Senator and challenging candidate President Obama could distinguish himself by taking a position against the war. It was not just popular, it was also what he, I believe, genuinely believes, and so it was natural for him to be an advocate for the position. But just the same, as we look at the politics of foreign policy, this was what he believed, but it was strategically advantageous in the environment of 2008. What does that have to do with the pivot? Well, as you might know, the image of a country in retreat is not attractive. It is not the image that Americans, whether Republican or Democrat, are proud to advocate. And so if you're going to have a policy of withdrawal from war, you need to have a positive alternative to put forward, not just to say what you are against and what you are retreating from, but what you will be moving towards. And the narrative that came out of both, eventually, the Clinton and Obama primary campaigns was the notion that Asia had been neglected and the over-focus, the overly strong focus on the Middle East needed to be lessened, and the attention of our national leadership needed to come to Asia. Now, it is without question true that many interests critical to the future of America rest in this vital region of the world. There was very little disagreement between Republicans and Democrats on that point. But the politics of this were essentially one of convenience, to try to showcase and highlight where new attention would be drawn in one region, and you would have somewhat of a division of labor when Secretary Clinton came into office at the Department of State. Her first visit as secretary was to East Asia, net positive for the region. At the same time, President Obama would try to set a new tone in the Middle East, offering dialogue and the opening phases of redefining what our commitments would be in that region. Now, as they began to govern, it became increasingly clear that we were going to have fiscal challenges that would make it difficult to sustain a large and globally deployed military, that uncertainty in the Middle East was going to continue, and as they tried some of the early initiatives under the pivot, they ran into some difficulty in terms of the priorities that were chosen. They tended to be emphasizing climate change, nuclear armaments, arms reductions, and global health kinds of issues. These were to be the new national security priorities in their strategy. Those priorities did not fare well in the first year of the Obama presidency. The Copenhagen conference went unhappily, and the moves on nuclear weapons had consequences for allies, which I'll talk more about later. As we approach 2014, we have a midterm election in the United States. The majority of the United States Senate is open for question. There may be a change, there may not be a change in leadership there. Every member of the House of Representatives has to stand for re-election. As we enter this midterm election, there are zero American politicians using the administration's pivot to Asia as a core point in the national narrative on national security and defense. The politics of the pivot came and they've gone in terms of politics. That's just the politics of it. Now, I'll turn for a moment to the strategy behind rebalancing, perhaps less dirty of a word when talking about foreign policy to talk about strategy. But strategy was informed by new priorities of the Obama administration, trying to shift focus away from military tools and emphasis on civilian tools, trying to emphasize use of intelligence, diplomacy, economic aid, and many, many other non-military capabilities. This was supposed to aid in the transition out of Afghanistan and Iraq. It was supposed to give new priority to the leadership that Hillary Clinton would bring to the State Department in coordinating policy across government. A great deal of energy was invested into strategic cooperation with major powers. Think for a moment. Who are the major powers? In the eyes of the administration as they began these efforts, that is Russia, China, occasionally but not always India, sometimes but rarely Brazil. There's more look at the BRICS than to allies when talking about great power cooperation. That would later have some consequences for how the policy is perceived. The emphasis on civilian tools and de-emphasis on military is very welcome in America. People were weary of war. It made some sense. But there was an unfortunate casualty in this shift in strategy, and it had to do with American perceptions of democracy and the role democracy would play in American foreign policy. For the most part, Woodrow Wilson's period to the present, democracy in some form or another had a positive role in both major US parties' foreign policy outlook. In some form or fashion, we believed in advocating and projecting the values that we saw as uniquely American, but more than that, universal. But through what I see as basically overly partisan debates about the nature of the Bush foreign policy, democracy became associated with intervention, regime change, and other very undesirable kinds of outlooks. This is unfortunate because supporting and promoting democracy and emphasizing relations with fellow democracies should be and is much more than those things. But unfortunately, there has been a de-emphasis on the value of democracy and how the United States should promote democracy in both major parties in the United States. Now, there are a few areas where I would assert that the rebalancing met with obstacles. Every administration, the one I served in, the one that has come after, every administration faces a challenge between what you believed and advocated during a campaign and what you can actually implement once elected in government. That we will all understand and will not be critical of. But there were certain, I think, reality checks that stood in the way of rebalancing and pivot. becoming a reality of its own. First, reality number one, the U.S. was not absent from Asia during the Bush administration. The problem that one might have had with Bush administration foreign policy was not absence, it was the nature of the engagement or the priorities that were set. President Bush attended every APEC leaders meeting. That has not been the case in the Obama administration. It wasn't the case in the Clinton administration. But President Bush attended every one of those meetings. He treated India as a global power and an Asian power, launched new multilateral security forum to try to manage things with North Korea. You can agree or disagree with the priorities and how they were implemented, but it is not absent from Asia. The second reality that I think the pivot language ran into was that U.S. deployed capabilities in Asia might end up declining, not increasing, in coming years. This may not be the intention of the advocates for the pivot, but the reality is, in 2008 on this day, the United States national debt was under $10 trillion. Today, it stands at $17 trillion. There is a harsh reality about what our national finances are, and there will have to be cuts. Secretary Hagel has talked about the number of aircraft carriers in our Navy being cut to 8. That will not be the only major platform that will see a drawdown. As we have wound down wars, our finances have not improved. It was understood that as the war in Iraq and Afghanistan would draw down and we would withdraw, that those resources come back to the United States and be used to fund other kinds of initiatives. Unfortunately, we have had an explosion in non-defense spending that now stands in the way of what we can actually do. And so even if we desire to reallocate from the Middle East to Asia, we will have less with which to rebalance. Third reality is, in my mind, the rise of Islamism, not the United States policy, is what's destabilizing the Middle East. All too often in the last decade, people assumed it was the nature of U.S. intervention that was making the Middle East an unstable region. We have now had a president who has very clearly taken a different approach to foreign policy. And not because of him necessarily, the Middle East is less stable. So we find the nature of the threat and uncertainty coming out of the Middle East as actually getting worse. Winding down wars and reorienting to Asia was supposed to bring about a different result, but here is the reality we face. Reality number four, democracy and human rights suffer under realist foreign policy. When you have a foreign policy that emphasizes the nature of relations between states, but avoids discussion of the nature of the states themselves, you end up having, I think, a less than desirable approach to not just human rights, but ultimately strategy. I'll talk a little bit more about that just briefly. Secretary Clinton found herself on both sides of this divide. You'll recall her first visit to Asia, to China. She made a very clear reference to the fact that while human rights would be important issues, we would not let our disagreement on human rights stand in the way of more important strategic issues. It's not a shocking diplomatic phrase, except that it very clearly states the priority of other issues being more important than human rights, that the nature of the Chinese state was not going to inform the approach the administration, like others before it, were going to take with regard to China. We set up a host of summits that emphasize strategic cooperation with China. A large amount of presidential time, large cabinet delegations go there. We do not have anything similar with Japan and India, two major strategic, I think, allies in both, even though one refers to itself more as a strategic partner at different times. But there is nothing to the level of engagement we had with China. when it came to Iran and the Green Revolution there, Hillary Clinton was on the other side of that divide. She was an early advocate for U.S. support for the protesters and the then called Green Movement. She did not win that debate, but she is an example of someone who was on both sides of this divide over realist foreign policy. The last reality that I'd emphasize before I shift to some implications for Taiwan are that alliances are less relevant in the new world order of Obama foreign policy. When the administration announces new priorities, they tend to focus on outcomes that emphasize negotiation or collaboration with non-allies. When there was negotiation over nuclear arms reductions on START, commitments made to Eastern European allies were pushed aside. When there were drawdown of forces in Iraq and Afghanistan, there was little to no effort made to secure ongoing relations as alliances with the countries we had liberated. When Hosni Mubarak, no matter what you thought of him in terms of his leadership and whether it was his time to go, his many decades of an allied relationship with the United States seemed to be cast aside very quickly as turmoil unfolded there. When a Chinese fishing vessel hits a Japanese Coast Guard vessel, the American response is for all sides to stay calm. That is not standing with an ally. When the question came to self-determination for the Falkland Islands, I'm sure that there has not been global attention paid to the fate of the Falklands for quite some time. But it would be relatively easy for any American president to side with self-determination of the people who had voted in a referendum to remain affiliated with the United Kingdom and to side with the alliance with the UK. But the Obama administration sided with Argentina in saying that they wanted to have dialogue to determine the ultimate fate of the Falklands. So alliances in many, many areas have suffered in recent time. I don't think it's by intent, but it is, I think, a consequence of the way the foreign policy has been conducted. So quickly move to some conclusions that I draw as I offer somewhat critical assessment of pivot and rebalancing. First, I think that rebalancing is likely to result in less change than people had imagined. We are going to have less with which to rebalance. The Middle East is going to remain a hot focus of American attention. And so we are not going to see that much net change in what America's role has been. There's good news and bad news in that. America has had a long-standing commitment to this region. I think that will remain. That's the good news. The bad news is people might have thought there was going to be more, and I don't think there will be. Conclusion number two is if allies and alliances are marginalized, the commitment to Taiwan is even more questionable. I have spent half of my life coming to Taiwan, and I think that this is an interesting and important part of the world. And so I don't say this with any joy, that I believe that American commitment to Taiwan is actually getting weaker. But I think that is a reality we must face. Not be sad, but figure how to change that reality. But if we are not standing clearly with treaty allies, the Taiwan Relations Act is wonderful, but it is less than a treaty ally. And we have to question where the U.S. would be in a time of trouble here, if pushed to that. Conclusion number three, I think U.S. failure to identify and counter the Islamist threat is matched by a similar weakness when it comes to the People's Republic of China. I won't go into great detail on this, but think of it this way. If we have an ideology and a movement that is aimed at attacking American assets, aimed at weakening American allies and aimed at destabilizing a critical region of the world, but we dare not name the threat. We dare not address the ideology. We will not succeed in countering that. Well, when it comes to China, both parties in the United States are shy about saying that there is any problem with China. There might be trade practices that are a problem. There might be some human rights issues that they'll talk about. But for the most part, they're very cautious about being clear. What is the threat that China poses? And it's not to say it is only a threat, but if you only pay attention to the half of the glass that is full, that part that is empty could be a problem for you. And I think that we need to have more honesty and clarity in the discussion about the nature of the challenge. And there are more analogies between the threat of Islamism and the challenge that China poses than people might like, at least in my analysis. Last conclusion is that the U.S. is likely to remain averse to intervention in overseas conflicts and continue to pursue strategic cooperation with Beijing. We talked about a notion of a pivot to Asia, but what it really was is mostly seeking cooperation from Beijing so that things don't get worse in this part of the world as we are focused in another part of the world. What we see playing out in the debate over Syria should be a cautionary message to anyone who imagines that the United States is going to intervene quickly in case of an attack here. Look at the process on Syria and imagine the Taiwan Relations Act. The example would be a missile attack occurs, use of some unacceptable weapon has happened. The American president said it's unacceptable. He has said he is determined to take action. But the country will be better if we wait 2 weeks for Congress to debate. And after that debate, I may or may not act with their support or without their support to intervene in a conflict. But even if I intervene, it will be proportionate and limited. And I will not seek to change the nature of the conflict that is occurring. I will only seek to punish the use of an unacceptable weapon. These are terrible precedents to imagine in forming handling of a future cross-strait crisis that we hope never happens. But real problems, it's not just this administration, it's the politics informing the use of military and national security affairs today. I think it will take some work to change that. Very, very quickly, I have offered a somewhat pessimistic and critical assessment. But in the end, I am optimistic because with every election of a new idea comes another election when it's pushed aside and something else is tried. There will be, during the Obama administration and after the Obama administration, changes in American foreign policy. I think the key for like-minded people and countries in Asia, especially those represented here today in Taiwan, Japan, and India, is to recognize that with America's somewhat withdrawal from this region, not a pivot to it, you may stand more alone in one sense, but in another sense, you may stand more united by relying more upon each other, finding ways to build upon your common values and common interests. Because the challenges you face, whether it be China's rise, the occasional instability caused in the Middle East that will affect the price of energy and other kinds of key factors for your country. If Middle East turmoil feeds into uncertainty in China, you will all face a common challenge in this regard, even if I am right that there is a declining American leadership in this area. You have a common purpose and an opportunity to address these issues together, more so than in any time in the past. So I think with that, my time has concluded, but I thank you very much for your attention and patience, and I appreciate your tolerance of my partisan views. Thank you.
Well, Steve, thank you very much. 戴天雄是差不多对现在这个主动的 一些外交政策有一些不同的看法。 针对台湾未来，安怎让咱做一个很好的一个参考？ Now I think it's time for to our discussions to come up with some kind of comment. 啊，这么三秒要先讲，恁两位要先讲，好，安尼好，我先讲，OK，Yeah，Michael，Yeah，Yeah，OK。
啊，主持人，啊，罗大帅。 各位朋友，今仔日有这个机会，再来讲这个亚太安全的代志，啊，甲这个美国的政策吼，我想这是一个真重要，对台湾来讲是一个真重要的这个代志啦。因为咱民目前面对的问题是，但台湾要怎生存落去？哦，这个甲有这个国际的这个因素在。不过今天呐，我是想不知道用什么语言呢，因为今天是我们是一个国际研讨会 （International Conference Setting）， and therefore English will be very appropriate. But you know, I think for the benefits of our participant from Taiwan, I think it's important to really use the local language. So because the issue you raise is really critical for Taiwan, and we have to face it.And the way we face it is for the Taiwanese people to be aware of the situation and face it in a square way. And so allow me to use Beijing Hua for my presentation. 我是觉得今天我们面对的问题的确是太重要，然后这个问题的解决最后还是我们台湾人本身2300万的台湾人要负责，所以我是觉得我个人的看法，应该想办法让我们台湾的同胞啊能够深切了解。那 you know for Steve, yeah, you know all kind of languages, including Taiwanese, yeah, yeah. 所以you know 国语北京话都没有问题。我拜读这个。Steve Ye 专家的这个论文呢、啊，我觉得有两点呢、啊、已经点到了，但是我觉得更重要的要再次的强调一下。第一点就是Steve Ye 本人的经验呢、啊，跟我们很多学者专家是不一样的。他不只是说对理论跟逻辑啊非常的重视、啊，同时他。在这个政府里边做过事情，特别是担任这个美国副总统的这个外交顾问，那么对这个执行的问题，对这个政策的设计啊，他非常的了解跟这个重视，所以我们今天有这位学者啊，很不容易的，他不只是说要建林呢、啊，也要建树。同时不只是说讲政策的这个理论，同时也要看这个政策的这个执行。所以今天我觉得我们这个罗大使能够请这个 Steve Ye 来啊，是一件很重要的事情。那第二件事情，我这个拜读这个论文呢、啊，这个 Steve Ye 很客气的，因为他是共和党的人，他是这个 Bush administration 的人，所以他对。民主党的有些看法不太一样，但是他所指出来的东西啊，虽然他很客气，这个有这个不同的观点，有这个政党的观点，但是我个人是觉得啊，这个pivot 就是转向亚洲或者是在亚洲的再平衡这个政策啊，像刚刚罗大使已经提出来。这个是对亚洲引起很大的这个共鸣。那么这个理论很简单的，就是亚洲的和平安定跟中国的崛起有很重要的关系。那么假如我们不能去重视这个问题啊，那整个这个亚洲的这个和平跟稳定啊就会发生严重的问题。那么这个是一个大家的期待。我想包括日本的朋友，包括印度的朋友，都有同样的期待。但是这个期待是不是真的实现了？这个就是这个Steve Ye 重视的，到底他的执行是怎么样？是不是言之有物，还是只是一个我们所谓雷声大雨点少？那么甚至于有些专家认为这个是一个 paper tiger， 是一个纸老虎。讲讲而已，没有真正实现，所以这个落差对我来讲是很严重，同时对整个亚太地区的人民，特别是对台湾，我想有很重要的意义。那么刚刚这个叶旺飞先生已经说过， 这个政策的转变从这个共和党转向民主党它的这个 context， 它的这个因素啊很清楚。一个就是国内政治的因素因为选举，还有这个美国人也开始对这个中东的冲突，这个特别是伊拉克跟阿富汗的冲突有觉得有一种厌战的这种心态。那民主党就切入我们就是要赶快结束中东的这个冲突，然后转到这个亚洲来。所以这个政治的宣传呢、是非常合逻辑的。然后第二点又碰到中国的崛起这个对美国是或者对全世界的民主人权都是一个威胁，所以我们要特别重视。所以这种政治的讲法跟这个战略的讲法，我想是非常合逻辑的。但是问题就是到底有没有实现还是只是一种文宣，政治的文宣，而没有真正做到实际的这个效果。我想这个是我们这一篇今天这个文章的这个重点。那我想我个人因为我们这个部长我坐在他旁边开会都很紧张，他对这个时间非常的坚持，所以我要赶快结束OK， 我是想对这个Steve Ye 的这个讲话有很多地方我非常非常的同意，同时我也提高警觉。但是我想请教这个叶先生叶万辉先生，我想两个基本的这个问题。第一个问题是，我们都相信美国的领导者还有美国开国的精神，就是对这个人权民主的这个基本价值非常的重视。我个人在美国待了40年，我觉得美国人对这个愿景对这个民主人权的愿景和平的愿景是相当的这个重视。然后他的外交政策当然也要考虑到所谓 national interest 国家的利益，但是国家的利益变来变去，那到底这个核心的价值在美国的外交政策是不是大家都忘记了只是追求这个政策，短期的政策，要维持和平稳定，要维持经济的利益，而把这个最重要的核心价值。因为我关切这个问题就是跟我们台湾的情况是一样的。我们到底台湾人有没有一个灵魂？我们是不是要认同台湾？我们要为了台湾的尊严去努力？还是说赶快做生意，然后中国的这个经济统战文化统战民族统战还有教育统战都可以置之不理？就是说灵魂跟现实是怎么样子去平衡？所以我对这个叶万辉先生的这个分析我觉得很难了解。为什么一个国家的灵魂好像战战就飘走了那么这一点我想美国我觉得应该反省，我们也应该反省。21世纪，我个人来讲，我是希望全世界能够走向西方这个民主人权法治的一个主流的价值。那美国到底还是全世界最重要的一个国家，你假如现在放弃这个观念我想以后就发生很大的问题。所以我个人我对那个谁的书这个美国一个作者Robert Kagan， 他有一本书叫做The World America Made， 美国创造的这个世界到底是什么，美国的领导这个信仰跟这个核心价值是什么。假如美国已经心态上被打垮了，就认为这个世界没有希望，这是马马虎维持和平稳定就好了。那假如是美国走这一条路的话，这个美国的整个领导力还有它的这个核心价值就没有了。所以我是很不了解为什么美国这么一个伟大的国家今天变成这个样子。 OK， 这个是第一点。第二点是跟这个台湾比较有密切关系的一个看法了。这个美国其实为了这种和平稳定他就支持马政府的政策。 哎，马政府很乖啊，对中国啊，就是客客气气的啊啊，这个接受他的这个九二共识，还有接受这个一国两这个一个中国的原则，或者现在是一个中国的架构啊，所以你很乖的话，就是大家相安无事啊。那么将来假如我是觉得我们台湾的民主政治啊，已经是要变成常态。这个民进党有机会执政，那个是以后是正常的事情。那假如民进党执政的时候，美国也采取同样的政策，哎，你要乖乖的，不要捣蛋啊，不要 rock the boat 啊，不要去找麻烦。那我想，对我们台湾来讲，是一个非常非常严重的威胁了。所以我是觉得啊。对这个美国的领导中心的这个基本理念，它的核心价值，到底在这个外交政策这一方面，战略政策是不是能够还扮演一个重要的角色？所以问题不是回到这个亚洲的问题或者再平衡，而是美国要不要回到它的核心价值来看世界，看整个世界的发展。所以我是觉得这两点呢，我有机会的话请那个叶先生给我们再分析一下。那么最后一句话就是，台湾的将来我们当然要跟美国维持关系，跟日本跟印度都要维持很好的关系，因为这个是这个主题啊，民主连线的一个价值的问题啊。但是台湾的将来还是要靠台湾每个人的良心跟良知去发挥。假如台湾人也跟美国人一样，现在没有这个决心的话，那我想台湾也会完蛋。所以最后啊，有点悲观的理论，但是请各位包涵，谢谢。
哦，多谢各位贵宾哈。我记得我去年来的时阵吼，我直接足无用的，用中文讲，然后爱替迄个斯图文 Bill Stanton 做翻译了吼，所以变个足无用。今年我看大家拢乱起啊啦吼，唔知要讲中文还是要讲英文吼，但是我拄只安尼想啦吼，就是讲，迄个我的中文的文稿吼，伫个一本内底已经有啊，吼，请大家参考。较等我讲的吼，是根据我。伊个即写诶，吼，我即马甲我家己写诶即，但不过甲翻做英文，因为咱遮有几个贵宾吼，英文未通讲吼，请大家原谅，多谢大家。Distinguished panelists, distinguished guests from Japan and from India, and we also have quite a few members of diplomatic community in Taipei. And I'm very glad to be able to come to this forum again to discuss on something that is awfully important.Not only for Taiwan, but also for Taiwan's friends, such as Japan, the United States, India, and many others. I read Steve's paper in great detail, and I have to tell you that I agree with him almost on everything, especially his analysis of the idea of rebalancing and how the United States is coming back to Asia, or the United States has not left Asia.I certainly agree with him on a lot of things. One thing I would like to reiterate is that we have a very strong sense of two things that might be in contradictory with each other in the American rebalancing or American returning to Asia. On the one hand, the reason why the United States wants to have that rebalance is because there's a challenge from China.Either economic rise or political rise or military rise. And therefore, we need to deal with that new challenge. And therefore, we need to have new deployment or redeployment in East Asia. And on the other hand, we also see many problems on the global scale. And China happens to be one country that can provide some help. And therefore, the United States would need to cooperate with China.Or China needs to cooperate with the United States in order to deal with those global issues, global problems.
But the way I feel is that those two dimensions seems to be in contradictory with each other. And if we don't take a good balance on these two dimensions, we might see problems. For example, in 2009, that was a year when the Obama administration was engaging in a very fast way in dealing with China. And in November 2009, the United States and China signed a joint statement. It's a very lengthy document trying to enhance the cooperation in almost every regard. But if we look at what happened in 2010, there was trouble in East Asia, there's trouble in East China Sea, there was trouble in South China Sea, and China became such a great challenge to the United States. And the United States has to shift its, strategic focus in East Asia. And in 2011, we certainly feel that the US and China cooperation is not as good as it was before. And I like the way Stephen has been describing about the US relations with East Asia. It has never left. The United States relations with Japan has always been very strong. The US relations with India has been getting stronger than before. US relations with South Korea has always been strong. And therefore, it seems to me that the United States and its relations with Asia, no matter whether President Obama is reorienting its strategic policy in East Asia or not, the US East Asia relations has always been very strong. And I encounter one issue, and I think Stephen also mentioned about this, is that the United States is cutting back its military budget. And I think it's going to have some impact on the US deployment in East Asia. I know one very prominent specialist who is a Japanese, but he studied or he does research in Denmark. And he says that the United States is not coming back to Asia. Actually, the United States is running away from Asia. And the example he cited was that the United States is ready to go away from Okinawa and to redeploy in other regions, further away regions. And therefore, there seems to be some contradictory in the way we think about the United States rebalancing in East Asia in the Obama administration. But overall speaking, we can certainly feel that the redeployment in Guam is a very important step for the United States to strengthen its capability in the West Pacific. And if we look at the figures released by the Pentagon in the last few years, the United States is going to have 50 to 60% of its service surface vessels in the West Pacific. And I think the United States is also going to have the most advanced fighter jets in East Asia as well. And therefore, you can see that the United States simply cannot ignore the potential military and security challenges posed by China. Well, Stephen comments about the current democratic government in the United States, but I think he's in Taiwan and he's being very humble. He tried not to criticize the Taiwan government, but I can tell you that that will be the part that I can play, and I can play rather well. Well, China strikes is a very strong challenge to Taiwan. And therefore, you know, in our perspective, we need to strengthen our relations with the United States, with Japan, or with other fellow democracies so that Taiwan can also work with other countries in dealing with that challenge. And if you look at the economic relations between Taiwan and China, we have more than 80% of our foreign direct investment going to China. It's putting all eggs in one basket. And if you look at our trade figures, about 40% of Taiwan's export is going to China. And therefore, you can see that when China is posing more military threat against Taiwan or posing more challenges to other countries, other fellow democracies in East Asia, actually, Taiwan's relations is getting closer with China, at least in the regard of economic relations. And what we see in Taiwan these days is that the current government is thinking about moving even closer to China economically. rather than seeking rebalance itself. In the June trip to Washington, D.C., taken up by Chairperson Hsu, we have already heard quite a few administration officials or those people who were in the high position previously telling Taiwan that our economic situation is out of balance and Taiwan's economy needs to rebalance. And therefore, our own economic capability is something that we need to address too, rather than Taiwan's economic relations with China. But if you look at the current government, you know, we already signed a service trade agreement with China without any consultation with the legislative and without any consultation with the sectors. And at the end of the year, we're going to have a commodity agreement with China. And you can see that Taiwan's economic relations with China is going to get much, much closer. And in the defense or strategic perspective, that is something that we feel that Taiwan may not be doing the right thing as well. For one thing, our military budget. President Ma Ying-jeou promised that our military budget will stay at 3% GDP level. But for last year, it was about 2.1%. For this one, for this year, it's still less than 2.2%. It's too far away from what he promised. And it's simply not enough for Taiwan to be able to defend itself. And I think one thing that is complicating our defense capability is that we are moving into all-voluntary military service next year. And of course, that will be a very expensive way of having the military service. But we simply do not have enough budget for it. And I think worse than that is that the recruitment for all voluntary seem to hit a difficult spot. We don't seem to be able to recruit sufficient number of soldiers for our service. And the way the DPP fellows would describe it is a service cliff. And I think it will be a crisis for Taiwan. On the one hand, we don't have the budget. On the other hand, we don't even have soldiers to defend Taiwan anymore. But I haven't heard American officials saying anything publicly about this aspect, and I'm a little disappointed. The DPP's perspective is that we need to raise our budget so that Taiwan will be able to defend itself, no matter whether it's self-research, self-reliance, or self-development of weapon system, or sufficient number of soldiers in the recruitment for all voluntary military service, and et cetera. It all takes a lot of budget, and we simply need to increase our military budget. And another thing is that the current government seems to have relied on China in almost every regard. And I just cite a couple of examples. You know, when we saw the Fukushima crisis, nuclear crisis, the current government thought of having a nuclear safety agreement with China. Cannot think why they would do that, but they did that. And when we had the food safety problems in the Chinese import, the current government signed an agreement with China on food safety. But up until this day, we still have lots of problems in that regard. When many Taiwanese investors complain that we need to have an agreement with China, and therefore the current government signed an investment protection agreement or bilateral investment agreement with China. But many of the victims of those who made investment in China are still not being dealt with. And therefore, when you think about China as the only solution and end up signing 19 agreements and still more coming, you are not going to deal with the problems Taiwan face today. And I think the problems Taiwan face today is our economy is very weak and we need our structural adjustment. We need to pay attention to those sectors that are weakening. We need to target a new sector that is going to lead the Taiwan into the future. But the current government is not thinking in that regard. They think only about China. Another thing that I thought is also very important is in the conflict or the division in between China and other democracies. That question is which side Taiwan is on. And I'm sure you still remember last fall there was water cannon shooting incidents in between Taiwan's Coast Guard and the Japanese Coast Guard. That is still a shadow. And not only the impression is that Taiwan is going against Japan and U.S. Japan security alliance. It also provided an opportunity for China to make its way into the Diaoyutai Island or Senkaku Island area, and now China is not leaving. And it becomes a nightmare for not only for Japan, but also for the U.S.-Japan security alliance relationship. And I know time is running out, so I just point out one thing. The theme of this year's conference is about democratic frontier. That means Taiwan should follow democratic principles so that Taiwan can stay together with fellow democracies, with the United States, with Japan, with India, with New Zealand, or other countries that have the same value, have the same faith in democracy. But just last night, we saw the news that our special prosecutors are bugging or eavesdropping on our congressional leaders, Speaker of the House. I simply cannot imagine that anything like that would happen in any other democracy, but the current government is showing this is what I got in my eavesdropping on the congressional leader, on the Speaker of the House. This is simply such a disrespect for the fundamental values of democracy. So if the current government continues to back away from our traditional allies such as the United States and Japan to go for China, continue to back away from those fundamental democratic values, I think we need to reassess how we're going to deal with this government. And Steve made a very good point. If the current Obama administration is not performing up to what you expect, you know, you always can have a next election to have a new and better government. And I think I can speak the same about Taiwan.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think our time is almost up, but 30 seconds to respond to Michael Kao, please.
I'll take 30 seconds in dog years. At the issue about values, I think, is at the heart of what the symposium is to address, because at least in my view, and I think many of your views, the nature of the state does matter in terms of national policy and international policy. And so we need more of a revival of that kind of thinking in America. Now, my business partner and I are going to try to launch a new initiative in the United States. It's called the Smart Power Initiative. But the idea behind it is we see a false choice between the extremes of use of military force and talks that don't actually solve problems. But there have been times in our past in the United States and elsewhere in the world where the tools in between these extremes were better defined and better deployed. I think that in Taiwan, Japan, India, United States, all of us, we need to fill this missing middle in national security and foreign policy affairs. We care about the nature of states. Not every country is equal. Equality actually is not a reality. It's an ideal that people can aspire to sometimes. But we are all different. And sometimes that makes us more useful, less useful, closer or farther apart. But when we have a greater sense for how we can try to shape events in the world, short of cruise missiles being launched from a distance, or short of a full-on military invasion, but also not just relying on talks alone, then we have a chance to be able to move our own nations and the regions in which we live in a better direction. I think that responsible people, whether they're in television, academia, politics, or just interested citizens, have an obligation to fill in these ideas. The people you elect are busy, and maybe they're not as smart as you are, and they might need your ideas. I know I do, and I know that in our government, we need more initiative about how to do things in these middle ground areas. Trade, how we speak, and other forms of influence are going to determine whether the Middle East remains an almost unending crisis and whether China's rise at the end of it. I remember a past DPP chairman coming to Washington, D.C. and delivering a speech that said, people talk about China's peaceful rise, but after China's rise, will there be peace, is the more important question. And we need to focus on those results. We need to focus on the nature of the states that are our allies, and we need to continually strengthen our democracies. I spend more of my time now at home dealing with politics and media, and so a little bit less of it in foreign policy. But when I speak to groups in the United States, I try to reemphasize America is an experiment. It's not a finished product. It's an experiment that's constantly becoming something. And it's up to us to continue to work and shape and move that experiment. When we stop, it will not live up to the ideals that Michael was referring to about our guiding values and founding principles. We have to constantly keep contributing to that experiment. And I think Taiwan also is an experiment that needs the same kind of nurture and growth. Thank you.
Okay, with that, that's the end of this session. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. 多谢大家。
Thank you for everyone. Now we have a coffee break before the next section at 10:50. Please welcome back to the next section at 10:50.